ready.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. Welcome back to this Mayor and City Council work session for Tuesday, February 26th. Prior to this open session, the Mayor and City Council, we had closed meeting and topic discussion were legal, real estate, and collective bargaining matters. And persons present were Mayor Rick Meehan, City Manager David Recourt, Council President Lloyd Martin, Council Members Doug Simek, Margaret Pillis, Brent Ashley, and Dennis Dare. Also, City Solicitor Guy Ayers. With us was Miles and Stocksbridge Associates Johnny Gilman and Mark Sloan. We had OCDC Director, Executive Director Glenn Irwin, OCDC President Bob Givers, OCDC Past President Todd Ferrante. We had City Manager Terry McGeehan, Executive Office Associate Diane Chavis. With us also was Finance Administrator Martha Bennett. We had our Human Resources Director Wayne Evans. And we had also Assistant Chief Chris Schaefer. There was a motion made by Councilmember Dare and a second by Brent Ashley to close the closed session. The motion was 5 in favor with Councilmember Matresik and Knight absent. All right. Next on the agenda, as we start off this new type of agenda, it's comments from the public. It's any person who may wish to speak on a matter scheduled for discussion on work session agenda may be heard during comments from the public for a period of 3 minutes or such time as may be deemed appropriate by the council president. Anyone wishing to be heard shall state their name, address, and subject on which he or she wishes to speak. Yes, sir.
John Atkins, 8802 Caribbean Drive, Ocean City. I thank the council for opening up work session. You know, I have one comment that was in your packet. It's on a truck that's being bought for wastewater. It's a Class 8 truck, okay, which is tandem axle. To give you a little background, trucks are rated from Class 1 to Class 8. Class 1 to 3 are normally pickups. You know, 1 ton and up. Class 4 is an F-450. Class 5 is an F-550. Give you some experience, knowledge, okay? To this day, Ford Motor Company does not offer a manual transmission. Keep that in mind. You all are trying to, the truck was budgeted at $90,000. You cut it, came in $114,000 as bid, which is understandable because of the EPA exhaust regulations, it has upped the price of a normal truck $10,000 to $12,000. I've got a magazine that I get. I'll pass it around to you because I want you to see it. It's a heavy duty trucking magazine. It's one of four magazines that I get monthly on trucks. I'm not an expert, but I read a lot. Okay. Delmarva Power, who I used to work for, hasn't bought a manual transmission in at least 15 years, it may be 20. The reason is maintenance cost with a manual transmission, and it's higher than automatic. The only thing I'd tell you to look at, and I know everything has to be budgeted, but when you spend $100,000 for a vehicle, adding an automatic transmission for 10, to me, is a small price to pay for lower maintenance cost. And also, when you go to look to resell this vehicle, and at some time we will, because this is not something we get rid of next year, you're going to get more money for the truck when it's sold with an automatic transmission than manual. And that's just something I noticed when I went through it. I didn't know I could look at your packet that you all get till the last public meeting. Joe Groves told me I could. So it's something that I saw, that I noticed, that I know you have to watch the dollars. No question about that. But when you're spending this kind of money, to cut something out as important as an automatic, to me, is just, you don't want to throw away money. You want to spend it wisely. And to me, that's something you need to think about. And that's what I had to say.
Thank you. Thanks, sir. Yep, appreciate that. Thanks for sticking to the agenda topics. Very good. So, anybody else in the audience? All right. Seeing none. Moving on, next is the new business. It's a presentation from Brian Lilly, Ocean City Air Show, LLC. It's an update on the June 2013 OC Air Show event, and it's also a request to permit the sale of food and beverage on the beach within the OC Air Show Center. Welcome, Brian.
All right. Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you for having me here today. I'm excited to be able to give you a great update on the progress for the 2013 OCR show. One housekeeping matter I have in closing out 2012 is I brought with me today a check for the percentage on the last outstanding sponsorship from Layton's Family Restaurant. So I'm pleased to be able to present that today, and I think that closes us out for 2012.
We appreciate that, and David gets that money. Yep.
It's made out to the town, right?
That's right. All right, and progressing with the 2013 OCR show, things are coming along well. I've got four new performers that I want to announce today that we're going to add to the lineup. We have the 101st Airborne Screaming Eagles coming this year once again, and they'll be jumping at our hospitality events as well at the air show and jumping the flag in at noon. We've got Mike Wiskus in the Lucas Oil Pits, one of the premier biplane stunt pilots in the nation. We've got the Geico Skytypers returning after a 1 or 2 year absence, so they'll be back. And then also the F-22 Raptor demo team, which we're very excited to be adding to this year's lineup. That is the premier single aircraft demonstration that you can have for an air show. They do less than 20 shows a year, and it is America's only fifth-generation fighter. So very happy to have the Raptor as part of the lineup and another featured performer that we will have for 2013. Wanted to give you a progress report on securing host hotels, because as you know, we've come before the council before and reiterated the importance of having hotel rooms to host our performers, and it continues to be a challenge every year, this year particularly so, and I want to recognize the hotels that have signed on to host teams this year. We've got the Quality Inn 16th and 54th Street, the Harrison Group. We've got Marriott Courtyard, Park Place Hotel, the Grand Hotel, the Coconut Mallory, Castle in the Sand, and this year a new commitment from the Clarion. So they're also going to host some performers for us. We did lose the Beach Plaza, which is right near Show Center. This year they declined to continue support and host a team. And we're waiting on a couple answers yet from hotels from last year. We are at 49 rooms per night right now, total committed to date, versus we had a total of 71 last year. And this is relevant and significant, and I wanted to bring this before you because, as you know, we need places to house our performers here. And when we get to the point where we start to lose these rooms, it's going to start to compromise the groups that we can get in here, the larger groups that take larger hotel room commitments. Just to give you an example, out of 49 rooms, the Raptor demo team takes 9. And so just very cautious when we get to that point where we don't have enough hotel rooms to host our performers and it starts to affect who we can book and how long of a lineup we can have. Anything, and this is what I ask of you, anything that the council can do to encourage the hotel community to assist in being able to host these teams and be able to keep our full four-hour air show lineup and book the top performers, the rooms are very critical. So if you can do anything, or from the standpoint of the city or the hotel and lodging association, we would very much appreciate it, and any suggestions anyone may have. Wanted to give you a review on 2013 sponsors. We've got a couple new ones that are significant, bringing some more of corporate America here to town. We've got sponsors committed to date, Brown-Forman, 5-Hour Energy, Carey Distributors, Taylor Bank, Bacardi, Geico, Hooters, Eastern Aviation Fuels, Coca-Cola, Ocean View Grill, and the Lazy Lizard. New this year, and first time we'll have an official vehicle, Ford Motor Company is committed, and Ford will be our official vehicle for 2013. We also have a sponsor, LJT and Associates, which is a contractor down at NASA Wallops Flight Facility, has come on board as a sponsor this year. So sponsorship looks good for the show for 2013, and things are progressing well on that front. And that is my update, and any questions you might have?
Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Brian. Thanks for the update. And as we have in the past, we're anxiously looking forward to the air show this year. It's a terrific event. You've done a great job promoting it and providing the acts necessary to make it successful. A couple comments with regard to the hotel rooms. I think really this is an issue to go before the HMRA, Hotel Motel Restaurant Association, about. There are partners, of course, in many things in Ocean City, and they benefit greatly from this. And I would hope that they would continue to work with you and be sponsors and provide the rooms necessary for your groups. So please contact them, and I would make this presentation to them. I know you already have, but I think you need to go back to them. Secondly, I had a question asked to me the other day, and it wasn't something I had thought of. But with regard to the federal financial crisis that's looming or potentially looming, hopefully not, there was some discussion or a question posed to me that could mean the cutting for funding for such activities such as the shows put on by the Blue Angels. Is that something you're dealing with or something you know could be on the horizon?
That is something that has come out in the media where the Navy has suggested that if the full sequestration takes place, that the Blue Angels could be subject to part of those cuts. We are going on what the teams are telling us right now, and that is everybody's continuing the planning. And I can kind of tell you what we know, and also, you know, we as a company have looked at it and already come up with detailed plans in a what-if scenario to be prepared if that happens. And I can lay both out for you. First, I know that both the Thunderbirds and the Blue Angels are proceeding with their winter training, and both intend on flying their certification show and getting certified in March by their leadership, which means they will be certified to fly the 2013 air show season. What's been suggested in the media is that if sequestration takes place, that the shows or their schedule will be cut or they will be stood down but still be kept in flying proficiency. That's about all we know is what we've seen in the media as well. What we look at it from a perspective of if that actually happens is we feel that beachfront air shows are in the best position to weather any reduction or loss in military support. And there are a couple factors that equate into that. First of all, at a beachfront air show, the airplanes are really, we call them flying fireworks. They are a reason to come to the beach, one of the most compelling reasons to come to the beach, just as fireworks are on 4th of July weekend. So it is a factor in coming to spend a weekend at the beach versus if you go to an air show at an airfield or facility, you're making a decision to go there solely based upon what is there from an aviation perspective. You're also making that decision because typically at an airport, you're paying an admission to get into the show. So again, those assets and the military assets, we think factor in a lot more when it comes to an airfield show versus a beach show. Secondly is going to be what we see as a contraction in the number of air shows that you're going to see take place nationwide. From what we're hearing, and this has already started, some of, most of, or maybe all of the military open houses at Naval Air Stations and Air Force bases will cease to exist under sequestration. There are a lot of civilian air shows, civilian airport air shows right now that are looking at whether they want to continue, you know, in the eyes of no jet demonstration team or lessen military support. So if you take the fact that, and we base this, that people still want to see an air show. It's going to be like when you say flying fireworks, we're still going to have the fireworks. They're just going to be a different type. And when you take and you combine the contraction that will happen in the air show business, combined with people's desire to see an air show and the fact that you can come and do a beach weekend and see an air show for free, those factors we think will weigh in and actually could end up as a net positive to a waterfront air show.
And let's just say for some reason it doesn't. What is your plan then?
It doesn't.
If for some reason you're not able to secure the Blue Angels for this summer, what would your backup plan be?
We fully, with whatever military support, or even if there is no military support, our full intention is going forward with an airship.
And that's good. That's what I wanted to hear. Absolutely. And I'm sure you'll try to get other acts to replace, although you can't totally replace the Blue Angels. But I just wanted to make sure that the public heard that. I only brought it up from a positive standpoint. Mm-hmm. That the air show will go on, and in your feeling is we'll have the Blue Angels, and if something happens...
That's correct.
We'll address it.
We're planning for all cases, and in all cases, there will be an air show in Ocean City on June 8th and 9th.
That's what I wanted to make sure everybody heard. Thank you, Brian.
Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Barrett. Councilmember Pillows.
Yes, Brian. Do you find that that we're getting people stay for a weekend, or is it just this one-day event? What's the hotels are saying? Are they getting bookings for people to stay a whole weekend as a result of coming to see the air show, or is it just...
Absolutely. There are some hotels that are on three-night minimums now around the air show. I know a lot of the hotels around Show Center are sold out or nearly sold out and at a tremendous premium on rate. Two of the hotels I know at Show Center are in excess of $400 a night on a shoulder weekend in early June, which is tremendous. So it is both driving occupancy and it's driving ADR. And so it's a double win.
It's a win for the town, but it might not be for you because you're not getting rooms now because they can be booked.
Yeah, and one of the things I think that factors into that when we get back to that rooms discussion, and we had talked about this at the last meeting, is to deconflict the number of tournaments and the air show in town at the same time. When you have a lot of major events vying for rooms, there are a lot that are going to Salisbury. I mean, there are rooms in Salisbury at Courtyards and at sleep-ins that are $169 a night because of the compression on that weekend. And so that's driving it. But yes, the success, our success, combined with the success of the tournaments all being on the same weekend are definitely impacting our ability to get rooms for our performers.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you. Right. You'll also have another request here. Request to permit the sale of food and beverage on the beach within the OC Air Show Center. Did you bring that to us? You want to speak to that? Sully, I guess.
Yes, sir. In order for the air show to sell food and beverages on the beach and in the inlet lot, there has to be a formal presentation by the city solicitor for you to have that. And we would ask you to support that for those locations. I believe you have a copy of the proposal in your packet. Mr. Ayers?
I can have that for Monday night's meeting. So.
Okay. All right. Councilmember Pillows.
Is there any change in the layout from last year?
No, ma'am. No change.
And we have gotten no complaints from merchants on that boardwalk about the sales of any of this.
We haven't heard any, ma'am. No.
I think you're getting more comments in terms of thank you, aren't you, than people complaining.
Yes, bringing people here, that's for
you're
sure.
You're bringing people to the boardwalk, and I think that's probably what we're hearing is that it's okay. They don't feel the competition. They are getting they're getting their share and more because of the air show. So,
yes,
okay.
Ma'am.
You want to move that forward to Monday night, Margaret?
Oh, yeah, okay. Move it forward to Monday night. I make a motion.
All right, got a motion by Margaret to move that forward to Monday night. Second by Councilmember Simak. All those in favor? The vote is 5 in favor with Councilmember Matresic and Councilmember Knight absent. We'll move that to Monday night for approval. So sounds like a go ahead. So,
all right.
Sounds great. Thanks for the update. The more performers, the better. You know what? Hopefully the Blue Angels will be here. So we'll cross our fingers for everybody.
Yep, we are doing the same. All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Next on the agenda is new business. It's a presentation from Chris Larimore, the fire chief, regarding purchase of a new aerial truck budgeted in the FY13 apparatus replacement schedule. Chief, how you doing?
Good afternoon. Good to see everybody.
Yep.
Our prayers are with those that couldn't be with us today.
Yep.
I come before you to request approval to purchase a new aerial truck for the Ocean City Fire Department. Highlights of the package that were provided to you and also posted online in the agenda as follows. The truck is an E1 100-foot aerial platform. It was originally intended as a demonstrator by the factory. It is currently online, being constructed, and it's available for spring delivery. This truck is by the same manufacturer and identical to the other two aerial trucks that remain in service. That represents a huge step toward the consistency of our fleet. The funding will come from the budgeted fire equipment trust account in the amount of $1,078,305. This purchase was planned in the apparatus replacement schedule approved by the Mayor and City Council on May 16, 2011. The purchase price is $21,695 under the anticipated budget that was set forth in that schedule. A committee of upwards of 18 participants have met over the course of the last 13 months to explore both the need and the suitable replacement to a truck known as Snorkel 711 that was purchased originally in 1965 with a rechassis date of 1983, far exceeding the customary time for replacement. We are requesting a sole source purchase under the guidelines that the manufacturer has already competitively bid under HGAC contract, and as mentioned earlier, this piece is identical to the remaining aerials in service, which has a substantial benefit to both training, service, maintenance, and it's a proven track record. I'll be happy to answer any questions that you may have. In the event I'm unable to do so, I'm accompanied by both Mr. Shopchak and Chief Schaefer to make sure that we were in compliance with all town purchasing guidelines, and also Deputy Chief David Cropper, which is the current equipment committee chairperson that oversees the specifications, the final build process, along with obtaining the approval from the volunteer fire company and the funding as such, which has already been done.
Okay. Councilmember Simak.
I'd like to make a motion that we grant the request of the Ocean City Fire Department to purchase the 100-foot aerial ladder truck and take the funds from the fire apparatus, fire apparatus fund.
Councilmember Pillis.
I'll second it and have a question.
I have a motion by Councilmember Simak and a second by Councilmember Pillis with a question. Go ahead.
Yeah, the question is, it's May of 2011, your schedule. So I am assuming that this schedule was fulfilled, like the ones that say immediate, they have already been purchased.
That's correct.
Okay. And so maybe we need an update because I couldn't follow along with that. I was thinking that we were behind on the schedule. The one that said, the one that's not to be replaced, 9, is that because engine number 9? You're not replacing that?
When the replacement schedule was presented to the council, there was also a consolidation of pieces of equipment. So we actually reduced the engines through that current purchase of 2010. We reduced the fleet by one engine at that time.
Okay. And so how about the one that's also due in a year, which was from the May 2011 schedule?
Right.
Are you getting ready to get that engine?
That's correct.
Okay. I just wanted to know the schedule was
sure.
Behind.
Actually, the schedule is current, both in the named pieces of apparatus and also the dollars. It was anticipated that in the calendar year 2012, the funding was there for the aerial that I bring to you today and also one more piece. So we're literally only 60 days in arrears, and that was done through the diligence of the committee to make sure that they got the piece that was correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Councilmember Dare.
Chief, a question.
Yes, sir.
You said replace, and so I just want to clarify because it wasn't exactly clear in here. The Snorkel 711,
yes, sir,
is going to be replaced and disposed of, right?
That's correct.
We'll retain 3 aerial pieces.
That's
and all
correct.
3 will be E1. And
yes, sir.
Okay.
Councilmember Ashley, you on?
Yeah.
Okay. Councilmember Steinman.
Chief, where will this piece of equipment be housed?
Headquarters company.
Okay. Thank you.
Same place as Snorkel, I guess. Yep. Okay. All right. I got a motion by Councilmember Simak and a second by Councilmember Pillis to move forward with the purchase of the aerial truck. All those in favor? The vote is 5 in favor with Councilmember Matresic and Knight absent. Thank you, Chief. Thanks.
Thank you. Have a great afternoon.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Great job. Yep. Under budget. Good thing. Next on our agenda is also new business. It's a presentation from George Thorne, Transportation Superintendent, regarding solicitation of bids for transit advertising. Brian, filling in.
I am Brian Connor,
Assistant
Superintendent of Transportation. Fortunately, George couldn't be with us today.
come before you today to request approval for solicitation of request for proposals for transit advertising. This time, we currently have a contract with Direct Media for transit advertising, and that contract was awarded on May 7th of 2007.
I got you.
And that contract is due to expire September 1st, 2013. At present, the current contract generates, on an average annual basis, approximately $210,000 a year. Being that our equipment, the buses, trams, ADA vans, are funded both with state and federal funds, we are required to obtain MTA's concurrence for this contract. We did receive concurrence on February 4th, 2013. This will once again be a five-year contract with an expiration date of September 1st, 2018. If approved, we're going to anticipate receiving requests for proposals being received by the Mayor and City Council on Tuesday, April 9th.
Okay, thank you, Brian. Council?
No. I'll make a motion to approve.
Got a motion by Councilmember Ashley. Got a second? I have a second by Councilmember Simak. Discussion? Councilmember Dare.
Hi, Brian.
Hi.
I understand MTA needing to approve this, but they don't need to approve the, or they don't require us to advertise on the vehicles to produce revenue, correct?
No, they do not require us to do that. We do that to supplement
our system. Right, because they treat us as a rural transit provider, and they've capped their contribution to our operating costs years ago. And we had to look for other means of funding other than through property taxes in town.
Right.
But that them approving this and requiring that we have disadvantaged business, is that?
Disadvantaged business enterprise participation.
Right. So we don't need to do this, but if we do it to help ourselves be able to afford to provide the service, then we have to adhere to their, you know, this requirement.
That is correct. Because the vehicles were purchased with federal and state funding, you know, the rules and regulations, stipulations with the procurement policies do apply. And because the vehicle itself is the mode of in which we're going to advertise, this is how it's connected. Yeah, it's a lot of work. It's a lot of hurdles. But it does bring more funding to our table to help offset expenses. So,
yep. Yes.
I mean,
yep. All right.
I mean, Council. We're subject to. Oh, I'm sorry.
Go ahead, Councilmember Phillips. Go ahead.
We're subject to their making sure we put the advertising we do put on their vehicle or part of their vehicle is to their liking. In other words,
oh, no. The decision of the type of advertising rests with the town, you know, make sure it's tasteful and it's
right.
Appealing.
Okay.
It's strictly the procurement policies
okay.
that I'm speaking to.
All right. And I have a motion by Councilmember Ashley and a second by Councilmember Simak to move forward with the transit advertising. All those in favor? I got five in favor with Councilmember Tresick and Knight absent. Thank you, Brian.
Thank you all.
All right. We're looking forward to seeing nice bids. And, next on the agenda is a presentation from Hal Atkins, Director of Public Works, and Joe Sobchak, General Service Manager, regarding a recent wastewater tractor bid and a request to award. Hal, welcome.
Good afternoon.
You're welcome. Good afternoon. Joe, welcome.
Good afternoon.
You have a tough time.
Tag team. Back on January 15th, we opened bids for a wastewater tractor. Even the lowest bid came in over budget from a company known as Western Star in the amount of $108,753. Had I been here in the meeting, I would have asked the council to remand them to staff for review. Unfortunately, I wasn't, and the council made a motion at that time, second and passed, to reject the bid. So initially, I'm back today to ask you to reconsider that vote, nullify it if possible.
See what happens when you miss a meeting?
Yeah. little background. Keep in mind, during the budgeting process, just like we are doing currently for FY14, discussions are held back in February and March of a given year to establish a budget. So it's almost a year later that we're discussing this now. We had allocated $90,600 for this vehicle. in review of what has happened in the market bringing us to this day, you can't buy this vehicle for $90,600, similar to what Citizen Adkins in the back commented at the beginning of the meeting. You can't. We've gone through it. We've talked to the apparent low bidders. It's just not feasible. So instead of following the motion and rebidding it and knowing that you will once again face the fact that you couldn't do it for $90,600, we sat down and went through the bids. The apparent low bid from Western Star was non-responsive, non-compliant, so you would be throwing that bid out in the first place. That led us into the second conversation with Barr International. Barr International submitted a bid that was, in fact, responsive to the specifications in the amount of $114,284. Again, your budget was $90,600. So in an effort to salvage the situation, we/Joe, because he did it, I didn't, sat down with a representative of Barr International, proposed some modifications that brought us to you today in the amount of $100,622. Still roughly $10,000 over budget, but in review of your FY13 equipment trust fund, you have sufficient savings from previous purchases that would be available to fund this at $10,622. That's what we were here to request today. If you wish to discuss Frank Adkins' comments any further, we're more willing to do so to see whether that would change your opinion on what you would award today.
Okay. Councilmember Pillows.
Question number one, Barr International, was that the very next low bidder or the very lowest bid of the ones that were acceptable?
That was the next low bidder.
Next one. Okay. And the other thing is, yeah, I mean, I did not look up if GM doesn't even sell manual, but do you all know that they do not manual transitions?
Frank's comment was Ford does not, and I have no reason not to believe him. Our current fleet of tractors in other departments, such as the construction division and in solid waste, are in fact all manual transmissions. So I don't feel bad about recommending that we would continue in that direction. Does Frank have a point that when you look at life cycle costs on a manual transmission versus life cycle costs on an automatic, that it may cost you more in the long run? You know, when this vehicle has 300,000 or 400,000 miles on it and you reflect back on what your maintenance was, it probably will. It comes down to whether you wish to take our recommendation of $100,622 and add an additional $10,000 to it. That's what the upgrade would cost you roughly to get to the automatic transmission.
Is that the direction that the department's going to head into in the future, or is it easier for the manual transition to perform the action that this, I mean, I myself can do both. I can do manual, you know, shifting, and I can do automatic, but there's pros and cons to both of them.
Margaret, speaking of a vehicle that size and coming from an individual that does not have a commercial driver's license, that's me, I would have to assume and answer your question that the automatic transmission would be an easier operation for the operator.
But more costly to maintain and to fix.
It would cost you up front an additional $10,000 allocation out of your transportation, your equipment trust fund balance, but would most likely save you in maintenance costs in the long run. That's when I use the terminology life cycle cost, you're reflecting on the life of that entire vehicle.
Why haven't you gone to automatic before?
We've just stuck to what's worked for us all these years and trying to maintain the lowest purchase price. That's the only answer I can give you.
The thing that concerned me, and again, I'm sort of just, you know, from aluminum and steel, was that bumper. I mean, the steel bumper, you know, you're in an area that things rush very quickly. Is that something you find a problem with your equipment, equipment?
You're probably right. I mean, it would be more susceptible to the elements. Basically, the aluminum bumper is put on there for an over-the-road tractor as a weight factor because it's very critical when you're carrying cargo, and they try to bring the weight factor down on the cab chassis itself with doing things like aluminum mirrors, bumpers, and rims.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not something that we've seen. You know, we have a fleet of vehicles that have steel bumpers on them.
Are they corrosive? Are they corroding? No.
Well, over a period of time in this environment, everything corrodes, but I don't think it's a huge factor. That's something that you really have to be concerned with.
All right. Well, can I make a motion? I mean, I guess this, we send it back to you. Is that what you're?
To summarize, and I try to put this in the simplest form as possible. One, I would ask the mayor and council reconsider their motion from the previous meeting. If that requires you to reject your previous motion, I'm asking you to do so. Two, reject the low bid from Western Star. It was non-responsive. And three, provide us a decision on what would have been the next lowest bid. We have a recommendation to award it to Bar International at $100,622. If you desire to go with the automatic transmission, I would simply ask that you acknowledge it will cost an additional $10,000 that would have to come out of the equipment trust fund budget, which in fact has those funds available if you choose to do that.
Thank you, Hal. Basically, I had the same conversation with Hal about automatic and manual transmission. I didn't know if we were moving everything that way or whatever else. But I do agree, if you can't buy this vehicle, and we need this vehicle, we need to move forward with the purchase. And I guess the question is, do you want to put a manual or automatic transmission in it? The staff's willing to cut $10,000 off the price of the truck, move forward. We haven't had any real significant problems right now with that. So I don't have the...
I'll make a motion.
All right. Councilmember Pillows.
I'll make a motion first to reject the previous motion of the council. Do I need to put a date to that motion? The date of that?
1/5/13.
Of 1/5/13. I also include in that motion a rejection of the lowest bid. Is it Western Star. Western Star for non-responsive vote. And then, or non-responsive bid. And then I make a motion to accept the bids. Be re-ran to staff for, and accept the lowest responsive bid of Bar International for an additional $10,022.
$622.
Well,
it is
$10,022 because the budget
correct.
Already had the $90,000.
Right. I already had nine. Right. Right.
$10,022.
Okay. For $1,022. So of $10,022.
In savings.
So in savings. Mm-hmm. And to stick with the manual, what we already have. Mm-hmm. It's proven and it works, and we all know how to run them, and we don't have any training. And okay, good to.
Councilmember Ashley.
I'll second.
Okay, I have a motion by Councilmember Pillows and a second by Councilmember Ashley to move forward with approving the bid for the tractor. All those in favor? I got five in favor with Councilmember Knight and Councilmember Matresic absent. Okay.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Terrence, was that clear enough?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Next, a new business, a presentation and request for approval from Planning Commission recommendations by Blaine Smithsonian Administrator and Matt Margada, AICP Planning and Community Development Director. Gentlemen, welcome.
Good afternoon.
You have two items on this here, so.
Correct. Yeah. Council, the two items are not connected. However, they're both obviously text amendments that have gone through the Planning Commission, received their favorable recommendation for approval. The gist of it is that the miniature golf subject, is adding miniature golf as a conditional use in the DMX, is seen as kind of a correction for it being cut out of the DMX from previous years. The subject of parking, due to an application some time ago, there was a need found to provide clarification. This was coordinated through Blaine and the city attorney's office or city solicitor's office, but as it was presented as a clarification language. And when you get into some deep language in the zoning code, I understand sometimes it can get pretty Byzantine and a little bit confusing, but trust me, this is a clarification in the code to how we interpret parking requirements. So that's the gist of the situation, but quite honestly, if you ask me a single question, I'll turn right to Blaine, so okay. I'll introduce the subject.
Yep, I like that. Councilmember Pillows.
Well, Blaine, I mean, the first number one, and I just want to separate the two for now, but the miniature golf, why was it removed from being MX district?
When the Ocean City Development Corporation sat down to do the overlay district with the allowed use in the district, they were prescriptive about those use that they felt were appropriate at that time. And I don't know that I can tell you why it was eliminated, but they didn't foresee that it would be in the DMX, because DMX is basically the interior between Baltimore Avenue and Philadelphia Avenue. There is some to the west of Philadelphia Avenue, it's DMX, but it was the areas that it would be identified on the maps, it didn't seem anticipated that miniature golf course.
All the way to 33rd Street for Baltimore Avenue?
No, 33rd. No, it only goes to 3rd Street with DMX, and it runs all the way to South 1st Street, and then you got I-1 Inlet District on the inlet frontage. So it was possible that it was just not anticipated that there would be another miniature golf course in that area. We had the one that was at the White Morning Condominium, where it used to be the Iceland Golf, and it used to have the Ice House, if you go back in time. That one existed for a time, and then we had another one that was east of Baltimore Avenue. It was a Tremper family. They had theirs, but that was in the amusement setting, so that one was not in the DMX, but it was in the neighborhood. Mm-hmm. And it was just not, I think that particular type use was not anticipated would be on the interior block, if you will, and it was left out. Recently, and in fact, it was a Tremper family that still has what was the tank battle, which was in the DMX section. They continued the tank battle, which was an amusement that had been there when it was permissive, if you will. And then we changed the zoning in 2002 to do the overlay district for the downtown. And it was at that time it got eliminated, not knowing that somebody would come back and want to do something. And that particular property is probably appropriate where some others in the DMX might not be appropriate, and that's why it would be introduced back as a conditional use, so you could weigh the impact on whatever neighborhood it was applied for. It's not, in some respect, site-specific, but it really is site-specific, as we anticipated probably be in the area that was originally an amusement-type facility. Give you a little bit more history. The Tremper family expanded their amusement overlay north of the Tremper and Windsor Resort up to Wicomico Street, I believe. Yeah. And they anticipated at that time they may have wanted to put it on the west side where the tank battle is. But rather than create, and I'll use the word controversy or concerns with the Henry Hotel, mm-hmm. which was historic in nature, they decided to not, because they weren't interested at that time, they had no concern at that time to expand the amusement overlay onto this property. That would have cured the problem if we had expanded amusement overlay to include the old tank battle property. It would have been permissive by that change of zoning, if you will, with the amusement overlay. But they eliminated that from the expansion of the amusement overlay. So that didn't fix the problem. And now we're back. We've been asking for neighboring legislation to put it back in as a conditional use so that a hearing would be held and things such as the Henry property and others will have opportunity to comment if they feel that the design of the miniature golf course is appropriate or inappropriate with its impact.
So, well, some of the standards for conditional use, do we know what they'll be yet, or is it just something now that'll they'll discuss all that? I mean, you know.
Normally, when you consider a miniature golf course as a conditional use, I don't think we have prescriptive standard, but you all always consider noise, lighting,
access,
neighboring property impact. We've seen a preliminary drawing, for an example. It's not necessarily applicable to this process, whereas they're going to create their parking lot will buffer the golf course from the Henry Hotel property. And as you know, we too have our transfer station right there. So, I mean, I think they're going to do it in such a way that it would have the least impact on the Henry Hotel than maybe some other use that might be in that DMX other than a miniature golf. So whatever goes there would have some level of impact.
So there will be lighting will be considered.
Yes.
And noise will be considered.
Noise, sound systems and all that you all consider. If it's a theme park, you'll look at its appropriateness and compatibility with the neighborhood.
Okay. So Do you need a motion for
this? Yes, we do.
This?
Yeah.
We're basically asking that we move it to, you'll take it for the first ordinance reading. If you're willing to move it forward, that's all we're asking today, whether you're willing to move it forward.
Yeah, I'll make a motion to move it forward. The miniature golf being a part of a conditional use in the BMX area.
All right. I got a motion by Councilmember Pillis. Councilmember Ashley.
I'll second.
I have a second by Councilmember Ashley. Discussion? All those in favor? We got five in favor with Councilmember Knight and Councilmember Trashman absent. Okay. The next.
I'm still up for a.
Well, yeah. Next question. One is. I'm gonna let Matt go ahead and.
Well,
explain what it is.
If you need further details, the other subject is. It was based on a specific application that the discussion came about. However, this is a text amendment to the overall text. It's not specific to any particular application. To us, it's seen as a clarification of the ordinance for interpretation purposes, and that's the gist of this situation as far as we're concerned. And wanted to field your questions, but like the previous one, we're looking for you to move it forward for first reading.
Okay. Margaret, you on?
Okay.
Go ahead.
So my question now is the language that you're clearing up for the area for parking and mixed use developing. What is that? What are the changes that you're going to, or what are the clearing up?
Yeah, go.
The clarification.
I believe that when we sent you in your packet, the new language was highlighted in yellow.
Yeah.
So that's the language that we're proposing that would be added to cure the problem.
Mm-hmm.
The situation, I've been zone administrator since 1985, and when I interpret the ordinance, when you involve mixed-use project, and there's basically two or three different types of mixed-use project that encounter this situation on how you tabulate parking. Shopping centers is one. And many times a hotel that has mixed-use, like gift shops, restaurants, salons, maybe in the hotel or whatever, the parking is determined for each separate use. Now, in a hotel, you get some discount, which is part of the same language. Restaurants are given a 50% discount, retail is given a 30% discount, conference space is given a 70% discount. The challenge that we got recently, and I'm going to jump back just a little bit to the shopping center. The shopping center is pretty universal. Currently, it's one car per 225 square feet of shopping centers that exceed 5,000 square feet of gross floor area. That's the flat rate. One car per 225 square feet. For basically a shopping center. But then there's a provision that says, however, restaurants in shopping centers, if they exceed 25% of the gross area, have to come in at a different rate. So it's not a discount in this case. It's an increase demand based on the restaurant being more than 25% of the center. The other thing that is in the shopping center district is if you have theater, it's a different rate. It's one. I'm trying to think this off the top of my head now. It's like one car per five seat of the rated capacity of the theater, which is a different formula. It's not based on gross square footage. It's based on seating capacity. So there are some differences in shopping centers that make it a mixed use. There are differences in hotels because of mixed use. I have, and this is hearsay now because Jesse and I concurred with this proposal, but then because we've been working on it prior to September when he retired, and he concurred with it as well. And in our application and opinion of the ordinance is that when you tabulate parking in a mixed-use project, you tabulate them separate. As an example, if a shopping center had a restaurant and it was over 25%, it's one car per 100 square feet of that gross commercial restaurant space. The shopping center otherwise would be one car per 225 feet for the other gross square footage of the center. So
you
each
said
one
car per 100
per 100 for restaurant.
If it's over 25%
for retail. So the restaurants were at a higher rate. So you would compute your restaurant parking, you would compute your retail, and the two together would make the total. It's almost obvious that if the restaurant's more than 25% of the total, it's going to provide a minimum five spaces, because there's another provision in the code that says, in any event, you got to provide 5 spaces minimum for restaurants. So that's a different issue. But normally that's not an issue because restaurants are more than 5 spaces minimum because they exceed the 25% of the total. So that's never presented a problem in all the years I've been here. Whereas if you get to a hotel, hotels have small gift shops. And if the minimum for retail is 5 spaces minimum or 1 per 200 square feet inside a hotel, even though it gets its 30% reduction, you might still only have to provide 3.2 spaces as a minimum, or based on the formula. But then this gentleman has challenged me on a hotel in town that's got a mixed use, saying, no, no, you got to give me 5 spaces minimum. Well, the hotel has several hundred spaces in addition to the gift shop. So he's saying I got to up the requirement to 5 minimum. And I don't believe that's so. And we've not applied it that way all these years. If there were not 5 spaces on site for the center or for the hotel, then you do need to have 5 minimum for the project, if you will. But to be inclusive on each individual use, that you got to provide the minimums, be it a small restaurant and a hotel, which gets a reduction, or a gift shop and a salon or whatever. We've never did the minimum for each individual use.
Yeah.
When we get to the end of the tabulation, if it fell below, then we would have to do the minimum. But normally that's not going to be the occurrence. So this language is written that we tabulate each demand separate based on the formula. When you get to the bottom, that's the total.
Right.
He's trying to demand more parking for his client. There's a civil case going on. He wants to demand more parking for his client for their reasons, but not for our reasons. Our reasons is to provide denoted amount of parking space per individual use. The case is total it, and if it comes out as an odd number, you round up to the next highest number, and this is what this was done for. To do it as we have done it as a practice, I've been here 28 or 27 years, and this has been how we've always done it. We've not run into this problem normally, even with hotels, because normally the minimums are already met. This particular case had a small gift shop, and it was like 3-point-some spaces. He wants to be rounded up to 5 and then get to the end and rounded up again.
Right.
And I don't believe that's what the code ever intended, and it's not been our practice. So we're trying to, Matt said, clarify. We're trying to do clarification to take away any ambiguity that might be
there. So I misspoke. There's no real change. It's clarification of what's already there so people can understand it when they read it because they are misinterpreting it.
But in talking with Guy, it was more than we could do editorial.
Yeah.
We had to do it by ordinance because it does substantiate a different parking formula, one from the other. We're trying to do it the way we believe it was intended, so it is an amendment to the code.
Yeah.
So it's not just clarification. It does, in fact, become literal enforcement thereafter. Guy may want to comment on the necessity of it.
No, he's explained it.
Right.
Yeah, good job.
It's an amendment, but not an actual change. I mean, right. The way it reads, and that's why I've asked you to clarify it, it sort of reads that this project is coming in and changing our code because it needs.
Yes.
And so that's not the case at all.
Right. In my opinion, it's more stylistic, but it is a code amendment.
Yes.
To make it right.
And I will make that amendment. I'll make a motion to amend the code for clarification.
Okay. I got a motion by Councilmember Pillis, and I have a second by Councilmember Ashley.
Second.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. To take the zoning ordinance text amendment to clarify the calculation ordinance form. All those in favor? Vote is 5 in favor with Councilmember Knight and Councilmember Matresic
thank you,
absent.
Thank you.
All right. Next on the agenda is presentation from Martha Bennett, Finance Administrator, regarding banking services and request for approval to piggyback the Anne Arundel County, Maryland contract. Martha, found some time to do something else.
No. I'm requesting to piggyback on the Anne Arundel County contract for banking services. This contract was bid in 2012. There were 7 bidders, and the lowest bid went to Bank of America. And according to the terms, we can piggyback on that. And that is one of the, on our purchasing policy, we are permitted to piggyback purchases for goods and services with any other municipal, county, state, or federal government contract.
All right, Councilmember Ashland.
And Martha, it says it'll save us $800 per month, correct?
Estimated, yes, sir.
Okay. Motion to approve.
I got a motion by Councilmember Ashley. Do I have a second? Councilmember Pillows.
I'll second it.
I got a motion by Councilmember Ashley and a second by Councilmember Pillows to approve Martha's recommendation. All those in favor? The vote is 5 in favor with Councilmembers Knight and Matrasik absent.
Martha, thank you.
Thank you very much. Next, under new business, is presentation and request for approval of FY 13 budget amendment number 1 by Jenny Knapp, budget manager. Jenny, welcome.
Good afternoon.
We have a PowerPoint?
Yes.
All right.
I do. As you know, the budget amendment is a cleanup amendment from everything that we've done since July. There, I want to step you through the revenue changes in the general fund. Other taxes, I'm increasing $229,668. This is an increase in room tax. The original estimate was $12 million. Revenue for the first 6 months is 5.46% higher than the first 6 months of FY12. This budget estimate, this increases the budget estimate for room tax to $12,229,668 and puts the proceeds, this $229,668, into the room tax budget. Under licenses and permits, this is a reflection of prior year critical areas and stormwater mitigation project balances brought forward. Under grants, there's a great deal of activity in this account, but the bottom line is $44,850 increase, bringing forward prior year grant balances, recognizing the grant for the outdoor equipment exercise area at Northside Park, recognizing additional public safety grants in the amount of $36,000, and it also reflects the loss of the tourism grant from the county of $270,000. Under service charges, we're recognizing a donation for Sunset Park Winterfest decorations. Other revenue is $401,000, and that reflects the balances brought forward for the mounted unit and the Tree of Life donations from prior years. Under appropriated fund balance, we are taking an additional $1,059,000 from fund balance in this amendment. The amended budget amount from fund balance is $3.8 million. 2.7 was adopted to fund street paving, employee bonuses, and a reduction of the tax rate. The additional funds are being used to fund the FY12 room tax over the estimated amount, and I want to explain that. There's a formula to fund the room tax. It's 2% of gross room revenue. So I look at that twice a year when we do the budget amendments. In the first budget amendment, I look at what happened in the first 4 or 5 months of the summer and recognize it and put it in the budget for the room tax. Okay. But for the second 6 months of the year, we don't have those figures until the end of the fiscal year. So I recognize that now in this amendment, and I'm adding that to the room tax budget.
Councilmember Pillow has a question.
The appropriate fund balance, that million...
59,000?
Yeah, that's coming from not the unrestricted reserve, but... What fund? Is that coming
That's
out?
That's the unrestricted.
Unrestricted?
Yes.
Do we know the balance of that once this million's
yes.
removed?
We
what
will
is the
get
new balance?
It's going to be about $12 million still in there.
Does that keep us at the 12% that we...
Yes, ma'am. It's a 16.
It's a $12 million. Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Other items taken from fund balance in this budget amendment are the inlet lot parking controls, the district court roof, and the airport boom mower attachment. On the expense side, you can see that the increases are in grants, $315,000. The advertising budget increases $352,800. This is also a net. The FY12 amount that was taken from fund balance is $393,000. The recognition of FY13 room tax over estimate was $229,000. And then the loss of the county tourism grant of $270,000 for a net of $352,800 increase in the room tax budget. Prior year purchase orders are brought forward in this budget amendment. Prior year donations, the inlet lot parking controls at $400,000, the district court roof for $36,000, critical areas project balances, the Winterfest donation, and the airport mower attachment. So the total increases in the budget, $1,780,000 in the general fund. Are there any questions about the general fund?
Councilmember Ashley.
Jenny, just for my own clarification, can you just walk me through it basically? I know you said we have a room tax budget.
Yes.
Okay, when I was in the motel business, I sent my room tax to Snow Hill. How does that come back to us, and how is it distributed from there?
They collect it and send it back to us once a month.
How much do they send back? Is it a percent?
Yeah, they keep 1%.
Okay. And then you distribute it into the room tax budget and the general fund?
Yeah, we have a room tax. We have a room tax line item in the budget, in the general fund.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. Are there any other questions? Okay. The only changes in water and wastewater were the recognition of prior year reserves to cover the prior year purchase orders that were open at the end of the fiscal year. And the same in transportation, I am bringing forward prior year grant balances in the amount of $463,000, recognizing $13,000 in proceeds from bus sales. The MTA has now, we are mandated to use the proceeds of what we sell our buses for to put back into the transportation fund and specific items. Bus shelters and bus shelter parts are some of the items that we can attribute that money to, or those fundings to. And then I'm also recognizing $1,153,000 from fund balance to cover prior year purchase orders. In the airport fund, we're in the midst of doing the renovation on the airport facility, and that's why there's $147,000 brought forward from fund balance for purchase orders that were open at the end of the fiscal year. We're not finished with the project when this year fiscal year started. And then it also reflects the $9,000 for the boom mower attachment. That was a transfer from the general fund, an additional funding. Golf course and convention center, the only changes here were recognition of prior year fund balance to cover prior year purchase orders. And the same in IT, service center, and risk. In the equipment trust fund, I'm reducing the cellular antenna rental estimate. Sprint and Nextel decommissioned as of 12:30 at the Worcester Street and 94th Street Towers, and T-Mobile chose to go out of service at Gorman Avenue during the tank painting. So I'm revising the estimate of what we're receiving in the cellular antenna revenue for this fiscal year. Also bringing forward $1.2 million in prior year grant balances. Those are the buses. Recognizing $350,000 in additional grant funds, which are also buses. And our local match, which would have gone into fund balance at the end of last fiscal year, is being recognized for the purchase of the buses in this fiscal year. On the expense side, again, that's the recognition of the funding for the buses. Reduction of, there's a radio contingency fund. You know that as we bring in the cellular antenna revenue, we are building up reserves in that fund to cover future radio purchases. So every year we budget a contingency. That's the difference between what we're bringing in and what we're expending for that purpose. So I reduced $60,000 of that to offset the $35,000 in revenue and to pay for the removal of the town's equipment from the water tower during the painting, which was about $25,000. Are there any questions on the equipment trust fund? No. And that's the budget amendment.
All right. Very good. Council? Need to move this forward. Councilmember Ashley.
I'll make a motion to approve.
I've got a motion to move approve. Councilmember Simak.
I'll second.
And a second by Councilmember Simak. We'll move this forward to the Monday night. All those in favor? Got five in favor with Councilmember Knight and Matresic absent. Jenny, good job.
Thank you.
Yep. Next on the agenda is a presentation of FY14 general fund revenue projections and discussion of general fund budget parameters presented by Jenny Knapp and David Recor, City Manager.
Thank you, Council President. Mayor, Council Members, I'll provide some introductory remarks, and our budget manager will lead the discussion, and we'll kind of tag team from there. In addition to the first budget amendment for the current fiscal year, your budget manager has been very busy for the last 3 to 4 months meeting with the various departments working on expenditures and proposed budgets for fiscal year 14. On February 14th, we received the constant yield tax rate certification from the state of Maryland. We thought it would be a good time to come forward and talk to you about projected financial resources for fiscal year 2014. We are, I would say, halfway complete or so with our internal review, budget manager, city manager review of our various departments, including general fund and other departments that are categorized by different fund types. Governments, you know, I'm not going to take anything for granted since this is really our first discussion with me as city manager. So I'll just essentially start from scratch, and that's really not to suggest that you don't know otherwise, but just so I know, and I may use different terms than you're accustomed to, and Jenny will straighten me out if that's the case, but we have a variety of different funds. We have a general fund, and when you think of the general fund, it's where governments typically fund their operations, their daily operations. We have enterprise funds, and an enterprise fund is a fund where government provides a service but yet charges a fee for it. We also have internal service funds. And the internal service funds are funded by administrative charges, and you'll see a variety of administrative charges in the general fund budget when you look on the expenditure side. We also have fiduciary funds, where these are funds where government has a financial responsibility to fund. Today, we're going to focus on the general fund, and there are eight major categories of revenue in the general fund. And what we're going to do is Jenny will identify the major highlights from that category, and we're prepared to discuss our projection forecasting methodology to give you some degree of comfort, you know, reliability on these numbers. I can tell you I'm very comfortable. I've worked with a number of finance directors, you know, budget managers. Responsibilities are a little different here in Ocean City, but I'm very comfortable with Jenny's trend analysis, her review of expenditures over the last 3 years, the degree to which she has analyzed both revenues as well as expenditures. So we're prepared to discuss that at in any length and any detail that you'd prefer to get into today. With each slide, with each major category, we'll also give you a summary of what the projection looks like today. I'm sure it's been mentioned earlier today. Given the projection for FY14, there's also an assumption that we will not use monies from the unrestricted fund balance. Now, we know that that has traditionally not been the case, as we just saw from the budget amendment. However, for purposes of identifying the financial resources that we have available to us for FY14, that projection assumes no transfer from the fund balance. That does leave us with a projected budget gap, and as we begin particularly to calendar dates for workshop and the council's review of the city manager's recommended budget for the various general fund departments, I wanted you to know up front that there is a projected budget gap. There are also a number of challenges that we face as an organization for fiscal year 14. We've articulated those in the slide. We can likewise assign a dollar value to them. There are financial implications for each one of those challenges. So our goal, in addition to educating, informing, forecasting, is to really ask the council today, similarly to how we handled our bargaining unit negotiations, are for some parameters in moving forward. As we address those challenges, we'd like to talk about the parameters that we have to close that budget gap, i.e. use of the fund balance, other options and alternatives when it comes to revenue and increasing our revenue sources. And we'll close with a tentative calendar. I think there the dates as far as presenting are solid, but depending on where this discussion takes us today, I may like to work in a special workshop where we can focus, you know, strictly on those challenges and how we're going to overcome them for the current fiscal year. So, Jenny, if you want to kick us off. And
Okay, in the general fund, there are 8 revenue categories. Real property tax is self-explanatory. Under the other taxes category, that's where you find the room tax, admissions tax, highway user tax, income tax, that type of taxes. Under licenses and permits, there are business licenses, noise permits, planning and zoning fees, taxi medallions. Revenue from other agencies includes grants from all 3 sources, federal, state, and county. Charges for services are fire marshal review fees, parking, recreation. Fines and forfeitures are tow fines and parking fines. Other revenue includes interest earnings, and then prior year reserves is the 8th category. For real property tax, I wanted to start with the assessment process. The assessments are done every 3 years. There are 3 groups of property assessed in town. All residential property is reassessed in the first year, as is the commercial property from 25th Street to the Delaware line. The commercial property south of 25th Street is reassessed in year 2, which would be this year. There are 610 accounts in this group, and their value is $7.13 million. For comparison, the commercial property in the first group has 681 accounts and a value of about $8 million. And the residential property has 31,410 accounts with a value of $7 billion. So you can see that it's not a large group that's assessed this year. However, the assessment did decline for this group. Real property assessments decreased 1.4% since FY13. And the revenue from property taxes in FY13 was $39,257,605. Based on a tax rate of 0.4585. The constant yield tax rate for FY14 is 0.462. The constant yield tax rate in FY13 was 0.4685. The tax rate was set at 0.4585. If the tax rate had been kept at the constant yield, it would have generated an additional $863,000 in tax revenue in FY13. If the tax rate for FY13 had remained at 0.4685, the constant yield rate for FY14 would be 0.472, generating an additional $850,000 in tax revenue. The revenue from property taxes in FY14 at the constant yield rate of 0.462 is $39,272,063. This is slightly higher than what was collected in FY13, because the state increased the estimate for new construction. They give you an estimate for the assessed property, and then they also give you an estimate for a property that's going to come on at 6 months and at a year. So for that new construction, they gave me an estimate that was a little bit higher than the current fiscal year. Are there any questions on how that's calculated?
Councilmember Billis.
Let's see if I understand this.
Okay.
What you were saying, if we had kept our constant yield rate or our tax rate last year, we would have had more money.
Yes, ma'am. We would have had $863,000. That's true.
So we had to deal with the 39,257. And that's what we got.
The 4585. You reduced it from 4685 to 4585.
And that's what garnished us the 39 mil.
Yes. Okay. Yes, ma'am.
And so now we want to raise it from the 4585, the constant yield, in order to get approximately the same money.
Approximately the same revenue. Yes.
Okay. We need to go to 4.462.
Yes.
Okay. I did understand it. Thank you.
Yes, you did. Are there any other questions?
Nope. No other lights. Go ahead.
Okay. All right, other taxes, income tax is expected to increase, bringing in an additional $75,000. Highway user tax is expected to increase $270,000. As you recall, in FY10, the state reduced the highway user funding to municipalities by 90%. It is anticipated that the state will fund 50% of the amount traditionally due to the municipalities this fiscal year. MML has sent us a statement saying that that's their feeling. In past years, the amount traditionally due to the municipalities in this fiscal year. So I'm going to put it in there at the 50% of what we used to get. It is in the state budget at this point in time, so we're going to go with that expectation. Admissions tax is projected to increase $35,000. Slots and casino revenue is estimated at $450,000. That is the actual amount collected for the past 12 months. Room tax is budgeted to increase and is budgeted at $13 million for next fiscal year. In past years, the combination of increased parking revenue, casino revenue, and highway user fees were used to fund street paving. In the FY14 budget, if we followed this methodology, that would result in $1,250,000 for street paving.
I'm sorry, what's the number again, 100?
1250, if we used those three items again, as we have in the past. This category increases $1,151,000. Most of that is in room tax. Under licenses and permits, the planning and zoning fees are the largest component of this category, and they are expected to increase $13,000. Building permit fees are budgeted at $550,000. That is the same amount that we have budgeted for the current fiscal year. Room licenses and alcoholic beverage licenses are expected to increase a total of $10,000, and the cable TV franchise is expected to increase to $910,000. This category, when you are reviewing the budget, it will show reductions in critical areas and stormwater mitigation fees. Those fees are associated with the projects that are managed by Gail Blazer. She comes to you from time to time and asks to have the money moved into the general fund. So it will appear to be a decrease, but it's really not. It's for projects that have been approved as we go through the year. So this category stays basically the same. It's increasing $6,300 for next fiscal year. Under revenue from other agencies, I have budgeted the county grants. I funded the county grants at the same level as received in FY13, which is $3,615,000. The amount that I've budgeted reflects the loss of the county tourism grant of $270,000. It also has slightly lower projections for ambulance and fire. They're both given to us based on a formula. And I followed the actual amount that we got in the current fiscal year, not the actual amount from prior years. In this category, we also have state police aid. It's anticipated to be fully funded by the state. FY10, that was the other number that was reduced by the state. They reduced the funding by 35%. We are expected to have that funding restored in FY14, and that will increase the budget by $151,000. Grants to cover the partial salary and benefits of the emergency services director and the emergency planner have been included. We are expected to still get those. And additional grants will be funded as they are received. So this category will appear to be reduced to $185,000. That's because of the grants we have received in the current fiscal year and recognized as we've gone. Under charges for services. Festival revenue for Sunfest, Springfest, and Winterfest are projected to increase $65,800. Recreation program, admission, and rental fees are projected to increase $63,000. Fees generated by the Fire Marshal's Office are projected to increase $7,500. And passport application fees are projected to increase $7,000. As the post offices have, the U.S. Postal Service has gone to by appointment only. Passport policy. More people seem to be coming to City Hall to get their passports done. So this has increased again. This category will increase nearly $144,000. Under fines and forfeitures and other revenue, the revenue collected from the police tow fines is expected to increase. The towing expense that's included on the police budget side, that will be one of the expenses that you see increase as well. Not as much as the revenue, but it will need to increase. Forfeiture funds and donations will be recognized as we get them, and interest earnings are projected to decrease by $24,000. So it will appear that this category decreases $371,000. And fund balance. The FY13 adopted budget appropriated $2.7 million from fund balance. Budget amendment number one appropriates an additional $1 million from fund balance. The FY14 revenue projections do not include an appropriation from fund balance. At June 30th, there was $12,605,000 remaining in fund balance. And since that time, we have reduced the fund balance to $12,112,000. Other considerations for FY13 that may affect fund balance at this point in time, Hurricane Sandy cost the town $1.2 million.
And we were lucky.
We're reimbursed at 75 or 20.
We will be reimbursed at 75% of the approved expenses.
But that's the purpose of your fund balance, is right, to pay for those expenditures, rely on FEMA reimbursement. And we expect, because of how well we're organized and perform, we expect that reimbursement. But it's a point worth making.
I'm sorry, would you give me the amount of that hurricane, the cost, $1 million?
$1.2 million.
And we expect what percentage of the return?
75%. Okay, in summary, when you receive the budget, property taxes will go down $182,000. That's because the estimate given me by the state for FY13 was we actually collected less property tax revenue than they projected that we would at that price. I will be able to cover that in other line items in revenue in the general fund, but you will see a reduction. Other taxes will increase by $1.1 million, licenses and permits by $6,000. Revenue from other agencies will reduced by $185,000. Charges for services will increase by $144,000. Fines and forfeitures by $45,000. Other revenue will show a reduction of $416,000. Fund balance will be $3.8 million less. So our total revenue reduction is $3.2 million. There are also items on the expense side in the FY13 budget that will not be funded in next year to help offset part of that cost. So the FY14 general fund budget gap. We have a projected revenue of $75,188,000. The FY13 approved expenditures were $76,655,000. So the preliminary budget gap is $1,467,000.
Based on a status quo budget.
Status quo budget.
Councilmember Pillows.
Is that with us already removing from the fund balance to 3.8 mil?
Yes.
As that's removed, and it's brought the 16 down to 12. So now we're still 1 million.
1.4 million short for next year.
Still short.
Going in with a budget at status quo.
And the reason you're not taking that out of fund balance is because, I know you explained it to him, but is because it'll drop us below where we need to be.
No. We're just that not decision, assuming that. That would be right. Your decision.
That's a policy decision that you've not made yet. That is certainly an option. It's an alternative. But we haven't discussed it, and without that fund balance appropriation, we just wanted to point out where we were. Obviously, it has an impact on the percentage and budget policy, and we're going to get to that in one of the next slides.
So the $3.8 million that you removed, you didn't need to discuss that with us. We just needed to.
We did discuss it.
Yes.
Because that you made that decision last year when you passed the budget to take 2.7 out, and okay. I'm coming back to you for permission to take the other million out in the budget amendment.
Okay. Thank you.
Every expenditure that constitutes that $3.8 million was made by the council right. And can be accounted for.
Okay. Thank you.
One more.
Okay.
And one more. FY14 budget challenges. There were 21 requested positions this year. There's a health care cost increase and legislative changes that affect part-time employees, or Obamacare. The impact of the union contracts. Increase in workers' compensation reserves. Technology and equipment needs. Building and equipment maintenance. There's a fuel cost increase and legislated mandates.
Councilmember Ashley, got a question?
Yeah. 21 requested positions. Are these new positions?
Yes,
or?
Sir.
They're proposed.
Proposed.
So we've just in the last couple of years decreased our employees by 100 or so. So now we're on the way back up? Is that?
Well, I think it is safe and fair to say that the city manager's budget, or the budget that is, I don't like to refer to it as the city manager's budget, it's our budget, the budget proposal, but I'm required to submit you a balanced budget, and I think it's safe and fair to say that the proposed budget will not include 21 positions. However, 21 positions have been requested.
Okay, and what, just curiosity, what departments has the most requests for positions?
Fire company.
Okay, thank you.
Councilmember Pillows.
I'm sorry. Did you get down the list totally?
Yes, I did.
Okay. So the impact on union contracts, that's something that we don't know yet, the impact on, that you're going to give us a cost on.
And again, following up from our earlier conversation, now that we have tentative agreements with both the FOP and the IAFF, assuming those contracts are ratified, we will absolutely be able to provide you a cost by fiscal year, because that's a cost that we'll have to factor in to the FY14 budget. We have that information.
Have you factored any portion of it, or is it nothing's been factored?
Not yet. As we prepared, again, with the projections, we did not. We were in the process of negotiating those contracts. The Obamacare, the health care cost increase, and the legislative changes for part-time employees, following our pension committee meeting early last week, Director of Human Resources and I had a very good discussion, an informative discussion with our health care consultant from Bolton. I will tell you that initially there was a penalty proposed if organizations did not provide the benefit for those eligible employees, and this is something that our organization monitors and follows very closely. So we, based on the FY13 budget, we had approximately 47 employees, if I'm not mistaken, that may have been eligible, depending on the number of hours that they worked. In that discussion with our healthcare consultant, initially we said we were evaluating the cost of paying the penalty versus the cost of not providing the benefit. Well, as typical with any federal regulation, there's some fine print, and there's also an affordability component to that federal mandate, and that affordability component is further indexed based on the income level and the number of household occupants. So the cost is significant. I will tell you that in our discussions with departments to date, I believe that we can effectively manage this or address this issue by management initiative. And that has been the task to the department heads thus far, i.e. that means an employee that we've traditionally used on a part-time basis that may be eligible may not get the required number or may not get the hours that they're accustomed to receiving. We may have to use more part-time employees to spread the hours out, but that's a task to the department head to address by management initiative. Now, obviously, that is going to have an effect on some part-time employees who have grown accustomed to a certain wage. But we have to balance that with the overall cost to the city for providing that mandatory, federally mandated benefit. So it's a challenge.
I mean, as long as we don't add full-time employees as a response to it.
Well, this is just for part-time.
Right, I know. So if we can't, I mean, we need part-time people, but if we can't get part-time people because we're not offering them enough time, then this may result into a bigger cost for the town by forcing us to hire full-time people. So we've got to make sure we don't move into that, you know, that process of hiring more people than we actually need just to avoid this cost.
And, you know, what is different and unique about our organization, our operation,
is that we're seasonal. And that's obviously why we rely heavily on the use of part-time employees, because you know, some departments cannot justify the need for having the full-time employee year-round, but can certainly justify the need for having additional staff during certain times of the year. So it's a balancing effort,
yeah.
And one that we have put squarely on the shoulders of our department heads to address by management initiative.
Oh, David, I like that word management initiative. It works very well. It works for all of us and every business we have. As well, and I know that we have beginning outsourcing some of the jobs we do, whether it's in Parks and Rec or Public Works or whatever else. We need to look at subcontractors to do some of our work for us. That now they won't be town employees; they'll be actually contractors, employees that would work for the town. So, all those ideals, I'm sure, are coming from the management team as well to put forward. I know the grass mowing has been one. We've actually cut back on Parks and Rec employees and stuff like that. And as we move forward with this, seeing what the Obamacare is really going to do to us, we need to look at more of that as we move forward. So appreciate that.
No, you know, and I'm think you know by now, I'm not one to come to you with a problem. If I do, I certainly want to have a solution. And part of our strategic planning effort was a follow-up and report on our revenues as well as options and alternatives for increasing our revenues. So we have a couple of ideas, you know, options and alternatives. They all are policy discussions that ultimately you'll have to make that will have a different level of impact on different constituents. You know, we've talked about and are prepared for moving forward with a discussion on parking, a review of our surface lots within the town, where we're charging for parking and where we're not, potential discussion on the inlet lot fee structure, everyone's favorite subject, the street ends, charging for parking on street ends. Again, not popular options or alternatives, but policy level discussions that I think we have to have and, you know, provide some direction on. There's been some internal discussion about a solid waste fee. You know, when you look at the solid waste operation, can tell you many governments operate their solid waste department as an enterprise fund, i.e. a department, a service that government provides but charges a fee for. You know, there is an equivalent. So if you look at Jenny's example of what 1 cent on the tax rate generates, it takes roughly 7 cent of our 45 cent to operate the solid waste division. I won't go through the full example. I've had discussion with the mayor about it. And at this point, we're not advocating for a particular position, but versus policy level discussions that we need to have, and that's why I was suggesting a budget workshop where the council can, at the 10,000 foot level, decide yes, this is something worth pursuing, or no, it's not, and knowing that what we face. Another option, again, I don't think it's new to the council as an opportunity to raise additional revenue, is a stormwater utility as a means for funding eligible projects in our capital improvement plan. So, I mean, we have some suggestions, some options and alternatives, but they are policy decisions that that the seven of you and ultimately the mayor will decide on. And those are just, you know, those are just a couple of the things that we've been tossing around internally.
That sounds. Are you calling me? Sounds like a tall order. Are we going to get all that in before budget?
Yeah. We're going to get to that and the anticipated schedule. I think we can. I know we're prepared to move forward with parking. I think that we could be ready relatively shortly on our solid waste analysis if that's something the council decides to move forward with. So yes, I'm optimistic and believe that we can get her done. Now, as you
get her done, you've been here for a while now.
Now, as you think about, you know, how we're going to tackle this, I'd like to take you back to that graphic that Lyle Sumick used. Remember the house? Remember the foundation, the structure, the roof? and then all the support underneath of it. It's a great way, you know, a great metaphor, you know, to use as your picture, you know, how we're going to fund, you know, certain, you know, programs, activities. Easy to do math, and you've probably already done it. But if you just look at the FY13 expenditures for public safety, police, fire, and our communications dispatch, and the solid waste, those expenditures totaled $38,640,000. Well, we just learned that our projected revenue at the constant yield is just over $39 million. That leaves us $655,000 to fund the rest of the house. So, you know, those are our challenges. And so as I look to address those challenges, I'm thinking about the house and what's in the roof, you know, what's in the structure, and then what's down in the foundation. What is it that we have to do? And it's no coincidence that I picked those two areas of expenditure, because what did we hear in our strategic planning session? Clean and safe.
Yeah.
Well, clean and safe comes with a significant expense. So, you know, again, we need to think about ways to skin that cat, and that's what our challenge will be.
Very good.
Speaking of the strategic plan, do we have the summary? Do we have the end result of all the work we've done? I mean, where the final?
Not from Lyle Stomach. I mean, I have it, what the council's top and high priorities were, but we do not have the final work product from Mr. Stomach yet. As soon as we do, we'll get it online, we'll get it here on the dais, and make it available to the public, because we've already talked about a number of action items, and it's no coincidence that I use that vernacular when I talk to you, and because I want to be able to demonstrate follow-up and achievement of those action items that we identified to achieving those goals. Yep.
All right. Okay.
Okay. Okay, so the parameters. The tax rate at constant yield of 0.462 brings in $39,296,000. If you had a 1 cent increase to 0.472, it would be $40,147,000. An increase of 1.5 cents would yield $40,572,000. Each penny on the tax rate yields about $850,000. The fund balance policy, the fund balance is currently at 15.8% or $12 million.
And budget policy requires
10%.
Did we not have a discussion up here 2 years ago, maybe three, that we were changing that to 12, Martha?
Yes, you did do that.
But we did nothing about making it a part of an ordinance to change it from 10 to 12.
No, you did not pass the resolution.
I also wanted to remind you some of the items that we've used fund balance for in the past 4 or 5 years. We spent $2,350,000 on street paving, $600,000 on the Art League building, $500,000 on the transfer station floor repair, $400,000 on vehicle replacement for an ambulance and a trash truck in the current fiscal year, $235,000 to replace the roof at Northside Park, and $248,000 Fourth Street parking lot improvements.
That's what we've spent this year.
That's what, not this year. That's what we've spent over the past 4 to 5 years from fund balance.
Four or five. Mm-hmm. Can I have a copy of that list?
Sure.
Thank you.
So if you think about your policy, what you've established as your minimum threshold for restricted fund balance, you have roughly $5 million to utilize in your fund balance. But you've taken your fund balance down to your minimum policy level threshold. If you decide to balance the budget by unrestricted fund balance, minus any other source of additional revenue or alternative that we may discuss further.
Right. I worry it's 2 years in a row we had to worry about Irene, then we had to worry about Sandy. You know what? I like the fund balance at 12, 15, 18%. I'd rather have it 18% than have it anywhere else.
So, why don't you make a motion for that?
for one, bring it, I can't, bring for it one, I can't 12, make a motion.
Bring it up to 12%.
We're at 15% now, so I'm going to.
No, well, not required. That can be gotten into because it's only 10%.
Why don't we have the budget?
Yeah, let's go through the budget, and we'll do. No, yeah, look, I agree. Don't get me wrong. I agree with 18%.
But you agree, do something about it.
All right, I'm going to hear the rest of the presentation. Go ahead.
Okay. The anticipated budget schedule. We anticipate present. The city manager will present. We anticipate that you will present the financial operating plan to the Marin City Council on April the 9th at that work session. We will start budget meetings April 10th and run through the end of April. Have the first reading and the public hearing on May the 6th, and the second reading on May the 20th. Again, we try to get that finished by the beginning of June because as the county sends out our tax bills, they need that information the beginning of June in order to do so.
So if there's interest in having a workshop to discuss, you know, and I would characterize it as probably an all-day workshop. If there's interest in having a workshop, it's likely would be the second workshop in March or a special meeting to be devoted strictly to these policy discussions. Again, I can tell you Terry and company are ready to go on parking. You know, Hal and company will be ready to go on their tasks. If there are ideas, suggestions that any council members have, if you're in a position today through further discussion to provide direction to us, we'll be ready to go on those as well.
I'd rather have a regular special meeting for that instead of scheduling the work session because it gets confused or tied in. That way we're not, you know, throwing two things together. I'd rather focus on the budget itself. And
I like that idea.
Regular works, regular budget meeting, workshop, as you call it.
Work session. We got to get him a work session.
Special work session.
Yeah.
So you don't want to have the discussion for any revenue changes we might make or anything on the budget that we might have a discussion in a work session. Do you want it a special?
Well,
meeting?
No. I want to he's talking about new revenue.
Correct.
We're gonna have a workshop on that. That way we have more time to discuss it. That way it's not tied into whatever else or people. You know, it doesn't get lengthy where you're here till 5, 6, 7 o'clock. We can start early during the day, and we can work right through it. That way we get all the information and work through it. So the budget, to me, is a working document that, as we see it, it moves back and forth. And Jenny does a great job moving that back and forth, trying to stay within the parameters. But we need to take our time and do it right. And I don't mind having a special meeting and doing that instead of having done a regular work session day.
So if there are ideas, suggestions, you know, options and alternatives from the day as today, think of them as the how. If you want to task us with focusing on the how or the what. I misspoke. On the what, we'll figure out the how. We'll be prepared at the work session to tell you how to do it. Yeah. We've come forward with a couple of whats. Is there any other feedback that you'd like us to focus on? Everyone's tracking. Everyone's, you know, focused on the task at hand.
Right.
Schedule a meeting.
Yep. And let's just schedule a meeting, and then and we'll give us time to think about it. And then, you know, if we need to have schedule a second or a third one, I'm fine with that.
Good.
I'm going to move forward. So.
So.
Councilmember Dare, I'm sorry.
It looks like this. Work sessions in March are what, the 12th and the 26th. I think 26th is during the hurricane conference.
Yes,
so that
we'd have to
might
do it before then.
Be an issue. There is the second council meeting is the 18th. And we could either meet that day or the Tuesday after,
right.
You know, the next day.
Yeah. Ooh, that's it's the day after St. Patrick's Day.
Like I said, the 19th.
The 19th.
Ready to
good.
Spend some money.
Yeah. Yeah, we have a Monday meeting, so maybe a Tuesday work session or something like that. Regular, a special work session for that. And then at the 19th, you got in the calendar.
Right.
So you're saying like March 19th.
March 19th, right?
Which you know gives you less than a month to talk about the revenue.
And then with
source ideas.
With some follow-up, you know, potential follow-up additional dates, you know, after that.
Yes, exactly. That still gives us time before the budget work session.
We can work with that.
And so you would do multiple items?
Yeah.
So are you now including, thank you, Mayor. Am I working too slow for you here?
I'm waiting for you to catch up.
I am trying to catch up. The problem is I'm hearing about it today. But so we are talking about things that he's already suggested. And I think I understand what you're suggesting. You're just suggesting looking at parking revenue.
Well, remember, that
was one of the items.
Goes back almost to, you know, a year now.
I know where it goes back to. I'm just trying to list it because that was hard to follow. And you're talking about parking revenue and then parking revenue again. I only heard, and then possible stormwater.
Yes, ma'am.
Utility and a possible solid waste.
Solid waste collection fee.
Collection.
We'd roll back the tax rate equivalent to the cost, and then impose a collection fee for both residential and commercial.
A collection fee, in other words, making a utility out of it.
Making it an enterprise.
An enterprise.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry, an enterprise. So that was three items.
And he also had stormwater management.
Yes.
I had that stormwater waste management as a enterprise, solid waste as an enterprise, I mean. Parking.
And again, whatever other options, alternatives that we come up on our own initiative, and including anything that you'd like to add as well, we'll commit to studying and bringing you good information that you can depend on.
All right. Thank you, Dave. Mr. Mayor.
Well, I think you already said it. Why don't you go ahead and, you know, give us some suggested dates and a list of the items that you've already proposed to discuss, so we'll have a complete list, and then when everybody sees that, if they have anything they want to add to it, to let you know, and we'll have those dates to have those discussions.
Okay. Yep. Okay.
Mr. President.
Yes, sir.
As David heads into finalizing his budget, in preparation before March 19th, I'll just say I think the fund balance at 15%, you know, anything less than that, I become uncomfortable with.
Thank you.
Because of what we learned from Sandy. I mean, really wasn't a major storm for Ocean City, but the costs were significant. Yeah. And, you know, I don't see those things. But as they always told us at the Hurricane Conference, it's not if Ocean City gets hit, it's when. So $12 million in today's economy in any event is can quickly dissipate. I'm concerned about the 21 positions that have been requested. There's a lot of hard work to reduce the workforce to right size it and sneak back up, so to speak, with 21 here and at the you've said that there won't be, I hope there aren't as well. The constant yield, I think that maintaining the constant yield is the key. It's not any more money. It's you collect this year what you did last year. I support some parking initiatives. Our visitors, especially our day visitors, need to participate. The revenue from the residents can't support everything. Looking at the cost of solid waste in the budget and how many pennies, did you say it was like 5 cents out of the 45?
7 cents.
Seven cents. Look at transportation. You know, in the past, one of the things that drove me crazy was talking about reducing the budget, but never talking about the services that need to be reduced in order to reduce the budget. When you look at the cost of what those 31,000 residential taxpayers are paying for transportation, I think that's going to be eye-opening. We may have to make some decisions there. And so that might be another place for you to focus in the next couple weeks.
Good idea. Yep. Okay. Fuel costs aren't coming down. You're right, in transportation for sure.
Sounds like you've done this once or twice.
Yeah. All right, anything else from the council? And sounds like we'll try to put together a schedule and try to meet on March 19th, tentatively right now, and the time will be just determined by all council. So.
Well, thank you for the date. Thank you for the feedback, and we'll stay on task.
All right. Thank you. Thank you for the update. Jenny, thank you very much.
Thank
Good
you.
Job. All right, Mr. Mayor, can I ask you to open the bids with David?
Sure.
Mayor's not here. Okay. Next on our agenda is a bid opening for bond council. I'm going to ask the mayor to open them and
Just read them into the record.
And Councilman Secretary Knight's absence. Yes. Yeah, please.
First,
thank you.
First proposal is from McKinnon, Shelton, and Hinn, LLP, from Baltimore. Proposal from Kutak Rock, LLP, from Washington, D.C. Proposal from McGuire Woods, from Baltimore, Maryland. Proposal from Miles and Stockbridge in Baltimore, Maryland. Proposal from Funk and Bolton from Baltimore, Maryland. Proposal from Whiteford, Taylor, and Preston, LLP, from Baltimore, Maryland. And a final proposal is from Ballard Spar, LLP, from address not listed, from Baltimore.
All right. Thank you. Council?
That's it.
All right, thank you. All right, Councilmember Simek.
Make a motion that we recognize the seven proposals, submit it, and remand to staff for review and comment.
All right, Councilmember Ashley.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Simek and a second by Councilmember Ashley to refer the RFPs to for the bond council to staff. All those in favor? The vote is five in favor with Councilmembers Knight and Councilmember Trezick absent. Yes, sir. Okay. Councilmember Simek.
Mr. President, I make a motion we adjourn to closed session to continue conversation.
All right. Got a motion by Councilmember Simek. Councilmember Ashley?
Second.
I have a second by Councilmember Ashley to return to closed session for more discussion. All right. What's that?
It's personnel.
Personnel matters. Legal and personnel matters. Okay. All those in favor? The vote is five in favor with Councilmembers Knight and Matresic absent. We'll be back after we get down to closed session. Thank you.